Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for a fireside chat. I'm Shaown Nandi, and I lead technology for AWS Global Sales. And I'm super excited to be here today with Jay, who is co-founder and CEO of 12 Labs. Jay, tell us a bit about yourself and 12 Labs.
Hey, thanks for having me. Yeah, so 12 Labs is an AI research and product company building video foundation models for enterprises and developers. So our focus area isn't, you know, video generation per se, but more around traditional existing video understanding problems like semantic search across really large archive or classification, video chat, to even now video RAG and video agents.
That's super exciting. Look, I was a media CIO for many years, and that would have been mind-blowing, certainly back in the day. When did you start out? How did the idea come to you?
Yeah, so we started the company pre-ChatGPT, so March of 2021.
Oh, so way back.
Way back.
From a generative AI perspective, recently enough in the world.
I guess back then, like, people, folks didn't really talk about multimodal, or I don't think, like, the term foundation model was a thing, right? So I remember, like, going out pitching, and, you know, it was like infrastructural model and applications are going to be built on top of this. No one believed, but then, like, kind of happened, right? So, yeah, and we were seeing this crazy trend of text, right? Awesome labs and companies trying to tackle intelligence through understanding language. Mm-hmm. But then we saw an opportunity and also, frankly, a really hard challenge of, okay, can we also tackle, like, video and, mm-hmm. you know, really start working on perceptual reasoning? So by the time these awesome labs and other companies that are working on language intelligence, if we can meet and converge with our perceptual reasoning, it'd be incredible. Right? So that's how we got started with video.
That's incredible. And you've built your own set of models.
That's right.
What are they? Tell us about them.
Yeah. So we have two models that we're really proud of. One is called Marengo. And Marengo is dedicated for generating video embeddings. Mm-hmm. So really rich multimodal video embeddings that basically allows you to power any-to-any retrieval, meaning images, audio, video, and text. This model generates embeddings from videos, and you can just power search, right? And then Pegasus model is our video language model, which is able to take in user prompts and the embeddings that Marengo model generated and be able to answer your questions based on your own content, right? So it gets used for auto report generation, to answering questions that you might have on certain footage, and so on and so forth.
It sounds like control F for video almost.
That's right.
That's amazing. So wait, first, before I ask you more about these models and how you built them, how did you come up with these names? They're super interesting.
Yeah, these are the names of horses, right? So we love horses at 12 Labs because it was the first thing that was filmed in video.
Oh, right? I don't think I knew that. That's so
about
interesting.
100 years ago, yeah. Right? So it was basically a bunch of frames of stallion running, and that was like the first, you know, form of video, and we wanted to, like, make sure, you know, it showcases our commitment. It's like, hey, we're tackling video, and our model should be named after the most famous horses, right? So Marengo is Napoleon's horse, so everyone knows about it. And then Pegasus, you know, the capabilities of that model is just feels magical, right? So it's like, what is that mythical horse, Pegasus?
The magical, mythical horse. Yeah. I love it. That is an incredible passion for video, and, you know, I bet there are a few people out there who did not know that horses were the first thing filmed, so that's pretty interesting. So when you built these two foundation models, how did you sort of approach this? Like, what was your approach and mental model, and how did you use, what kind of tool sets did you use ultimately, or were you using today at least to work with them?
Yeah, so we do a lot of, you know, novel research around, like, architecture, model architectures that's, you know, more suited for video, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, the need for video native video embedding model is, like, was clear to us, right? Okay, there's a bunch of, like, text embedding models and image embedding models, but video is an entirely different beast. So why don't we have it? Mm-hmm. So we should start building it. So and so that's, like, the research side of things, but, like, the nitty-gritty engineering work that needs to be done, you know, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. So, you know, we work really closely with, you know, the HyperPod team, right? Where, you know, we leverage the resilience and the awesome distributed training infrastructure that you've built, which allows us to actually, like, spin up these awesome GPUs, train the models as quickly as we can, and ship it, right? And that's, like, one of many things that we do. and video also is like a very visual thing, right? So whenever you do things, you search for things, visual thing pops up, right? So we, you know, we leverage the streaming infrastructure, media convert that AWS also invented, and that like allows us to keep focus on what we're really good at.
Tell me a little bit more about your experience with SageMaker HyperPod. How did it really unblock you in building these models?
I think probably one of the most challenging thing about building these kind of models is, you know, we are working with really, really powerful machines at an incredible scale, from like hundreds of GPUs to maybe tens of thousands of GPUs. And even though these are really well built and robust, you know, often cases, very often, there are a lot of like hardware failures and node failures, which affects training, mm-hmm. right? And it makes a lot of scientists go crazy, right? So HyperPod, like the promise of, you know, reviving the dead nodes and resilience and being able to like basically outsource mm-hmm. high performance computing mm-hmm. was like really appealing to us, right? So
you didn't have to think about it. Your scientists didn't have to deal with sort of the gorp of trying to figure out when a node was killed or having problematic or interrupting training. They could just sort of go.
That's right. That's right. And I'm sure our scientists' time are better spent on thinking about the models, the data, than trying to fix all this crazy hardware issues.
And tell me a little bit about how, you know, customers, companies, and startups, whoever, how are they consuming your models? You mentioned there's lots of interesting use cases.
Yeah, so I think, you know, this whole Gen AI kind of explosion is very, very exciting, mm-hmm. right? But I think it started with, like, LLMs, mm-hmm. right? But for companies that are video-centric, that own large amounts of video content, and that's their source of kind of revenue, they feel like they're missing out on, hey, where's our version of enterprise search? Where's our video reg? Where's our video chat, video search, right? So, you know, 12 Labs help address that, right? And we bring the gold standard solutions for these folks to actually essentially make sense of petabytes worth of video archive mm-hmm. That they own. Right. So from like media, entertainment and sports to public sectors, we help all of the videos searchable.
That's awesome. And how do these companies sort of consume your foundation models? Do you provide it to them and they run it themselves, or what's the mental model there?
Yeah. So they consume our models via, you know, APIs, right? Integrate our model capabilities into their video centric applications, and they build or they enhance. So that's pretty smooth, but I think there are deeper integrations that we're working with that we're really excited about.
And tell me about like some of the challenges you're seeing with your customers when they're working with these models. What are some of the things you hope you can surmount in the next months, years, et cetera?
Yeah. So I think for our customers, and this is something that like our customers and we are also working together, is I think, you know, when it comes to Gen AI technology, because it's so capable, mm-hmm. It's sometimes hard to stay focused, right? So knowing what we actually want to power and how do we properly evaluate the systems is very important, right? And also for us as a model provider, we don't just want to shatter like academic benchmark, right? We want to be able to procure, acquire, and build evaluation data set for our models that's actually resonant, like that actually makes sense for our customers, right? So these are some of the things that we're working on, and we're making really good progress.
That's excellent. So what do you see coming next in the future? Not your roadmap per se, but what sorts of things do you think enterprises, companies are going to see from providers like yourself, model providers?
Yeah, I think really highly focused modality-specific foundation models that just nails some of the existing hair on fire problems, right? So for us, you know, we're starting off with video search, mm-hmm. but, you know, being able to search for things and retrieve really quickly is like the foundation of building really, really robust agent system, mm-hmm. right? So one of our joint customers, MLSC, Maple mm-hmm. Leaf Sports, they're awesome, awesome people, pioneers of sports entertainment industry. They've built this incredible video agent for post-production, right? And they were able to kind of reduce the time it took to produce a content from like multi-weeks to like multi-hours maybe.
Wow.
So that's like incredible amount of efficiency gain. And I think we're just going to see a lot of that happen, right? And it's not just going to come like gradually, because as these systems become more and more capable, and once the systems cross certain threshold, then there's just an explosion of use cases being powered overnight.
Right. I love it. And so that's interesting, because that means companies are going to be able to get to their customers, their fans. They're going to get content to them so much faster if they can do this.
That's right. Yeah. And it's going to really, really like empower the viewers too, because you will now be experiencing truly personalized content, a journey, basically, right? You ask this capable systems, hey, these are the things that I care about. I like this.
It comes to you.
And then it just dynamically gets served.
That's incredible. That's incredible. Mm-hmm. And tell me a little bit about like what your customers are telling you about their experiences. Obviously, you gave a couple few great examples, but what are your customers telling about their experience with the models?
Yeah, great, right? So, you know, we've been, so we're really appreciative and grateful for our customers and, you know, really sharing what they need, right? It's the ability, the models need to be good. So our models are there. But then the ability to really quickly fine tune our models mm-hmm. and make it their own, mm-hmm. right? And that's been like working fantastically, right? So really empowering our customers that, hey, our job is to train really, really capable base models. Here's the model, and you can take your proprietary data, fine tune it, and it's all yours, right? And that's been like a really, really awesome experience. That our customers have been telling us about. And then, you know, once you start interacting with these models, the capabilities, they think about a lot of the crazy use cases that they had that they stored in the back burner because it was possible.
Just wasn't possible.
Yeah, now they come out of woodwork, right? And it gets powered.
Tell me a little bit about like how your customers are working with your models. Are they tending to fine tune them? Are they doing model distillation? Are they just using them as is? What's the experience been like?
So 12 Labs models are quite capable. So in some like general tasks, our base models just get used, right? So we have, you know, self-serve version of our models and our APIs. And these are usually startups that are building video-centric applications. They just go get the API key and start building. But then there are customers that own really, really niche content. Mm-hmm. It could be very specific sports to healthcare mm-hmm. domain. And these are rare footages. And you know, our customers are really proud of the data that they've gathered, you know, throughout years. And we allow them to fine-tune our models. And that model belongs to you, the fine-tuned models, right? And just building entirely new experiences on top of their fine-tuned model has been great.
So how often do you end up having to release new versions of models, and is it still going rapid evolution and change, or what's that pace and timing like?
Yeah, so we want to be thoughtful about model releases, right? But we want to release new models quite frequently, but do it in a very thoughtful manner. Not just like to release new models for the sake of releasing new models, but really what are some of the capabilities that our models don't have today that our customers have been asking, right? Once we know that, then we should iterate fast, right? So, you know, there's no like, oh, 12 Labs releases models in like every 4 weeks or two or 8 weeks, yeah. but once we know exactly what kind of new capabilities that we should be adding, then it's off to the chases. It's ASAP, right?
I love it. That makes so much sense. What do you, any advice for companies out there that are consuming models like yours via API on things they should look for and how they should sort of test and evaluate models, especially ones that are in unique spaces like yours is?
Right. So I think going back, first, I think what's really important, especially for customers with lots of video content, is first knowing where to put that data, mm-hmm. right? So making sure that infrastructurally you're set up for success, right? So, you know, putting data where it needs to be is harder than you think, you know, right? So that's important. Second is like knowing exactly what you want and having a robust evaluation data set that actually translates into success, right? So this data set is almost like a North Star, right? With high confidence, if the model performs really well on this data set, then we can kind of infer that the production grade solution that, that you build on top of our models will be great, right? And then lastly, making sure that your training data set is in good shape, right? And you know, I think, and this happens with like interacting with us, you know? Come talk to us about your use case and we can also help you figure out, right? Because this is part of like collective journey, right?
So. I love it. And so I want to thank you for coming here today and spending time with us. We can't wait to see what's next from 12 Labs. It's pretty exciting. And congratulations on all your recent model releases. I know customers are super excited about it.
Thank you for having us.